kind of thing, then you will also understand what may happen to mankind. You see, when a higher order is created, the lower order is not totally wiped out. It continues to survive. But in comparison to the higher order, it is subjugated to a lower position of subjugation and relevant unimportance. And it is, whenever there is a question of confrontation between the higher order and the lower order, the higher order has the capability of defeating comparative lower order. So it has an edge, over the species which is related to the past. That is how the evolution takes place, step after step. Now mankind, for instance, has reached a stage of evolution where all the rest of the animal life is relegated to lower orders compared to man. You can never conceive a situation where lions would take over the world again, or elephants, or any other species. Attempts may be made by bacteria, for instance, but they will always be defeated because a superior being is created, and that is now the sovereign of the universe as compared to the dictation is concerned. They dictate terms, not the species of the lower order. Something like that is going to happen to the doomsday of man. Talking in terms of the doomsday, man will no longer be supreme in this world. Man will not be totally destroyed, studying from the God's conduct in relation to the animals. This is what I understand. Man will survive, but survive a life which is, will be, is dishonorable for him. A superior species will come to rule and dictate terms. So it will be a subservient life of man from then on, and that would be the doomsday for that man. As far as the total destruction of the world is concerned, that would come much, much later. So much later that it's inconceivable, and we cannot really reckon the time according to our human experience, because the life left to the molecules in the inbuilt system is yet left to such a large degree that I shouldn't be surprised if it takes many billions of years for the protons, etc., to get exhausted. So when that happens, then a doomsday can take place. That is to say, naturally, automatically, without a foreign interference. Yet I also suspect the possibility of an earlier doomsday, if God so decides to finish this world by, for instance, bombardment of meteors from, or collision of a star with this earth. So if that happens, even a small collision can create disaster for the whole life on earth. In that scenario, what is possible is that some accident takes place, which is accident from our point of view, but is a designed move by God to destroy the previous era of life on earth. So if that happens, then of course mankind would certainly be destroyed. But then what would happen to the new species which you find mentioned in the Quran? That is a problem. That is why I ruled it out in the beginning. I believe if this is to happen, it will happen again at a much, much later date. Mankind has been given a very large span of existence and still will be given some more. So when it is ultimately rejected by God, the new species also would be given a very large span of time, maybe comparatively longer. So if that happens, then even the accidental doomsday, as I have just mentioned, is still seems to be very far from us. Right? Exactly. Thank you. Yes? A question from the ladies and then your turn.
So, 4 questions have been received from ladies' side who are also participating and benefiting from this Majlis Irfan. The first question says that, could you please give us some explanation of the spirit of Jesus, peace be upon him?
Spirit of Jesus?
Yes, that's what they
mean by that. What does the questioner mean by that?
Just that much is written there, the spirit of Jesus. Just they want to have some elaboration on this point, spirit of Jesus.
Spirit in the sense of soul or the spirit of Christianity? The two different things. When you say spirit of Jesus, that seems to refer to the soul of Jesus.
Yes.
His soul was no different from other human souls.
Yeah.
So that is the answer if that is the question. But if by spirit of Jesus the lady wants to, the lady refers to the spirit of Christianity, then of course it's a different issue altogether.
Yes.
So because from one angle the question has been answered, let's now shift to the second one, please.
Yeah. The second one is, a lady has written that she has heard from somewhere that the bodies of the righteous people and also the bodies of the prophets, when they are buried in the grave, they do not decay and remain intact. What is the truth about that?
That's not true. I mean, what is not true is any such law that the body of a pious person will never decay is not true. But it happens sometimes. That is true. In some cases, the bodies do not decay because some natural phenomenon takes place of mummification of some sort. We don't know the factors in detail, but we have full evidence that in many cases bodies of certain pious people did not go into decay. I mean, decay to the degree that this disintegration caused obnoxious gases to be emitted and the whole face to be eaten up by holes and things. Of that we have historical evidence at the time of Hazrat Muhammad Rasulullah Sallam himself, when the grave of some companions were dug up. I mean, that happened later on. At the time of Rasulullah Sallam, some companions of Rasulullah Sallam after Jangi Uhud were buried together in a mass grave. Later on, perhaps, I don't remember exactly during his time or later on, their bodies were unearthed and proper separate burial was given. And the historians tell us that when this happened, the bodies remained recognizable and they had not gone through the same process of decay which is normally witnessed. But that is history. Something we have witnessed now in our time is undeniable because it has been supported by the non-Ahmadi witnesses as well. I think it was Bahawalpur or Multan, somewhere in the south, northern Punjab, so southern Punjab, in Ahmadis, I think it was Laya, that an Ahmadi's grave was ordered to be dug up and the body removed from the cemetery because the mullahs had claimed it was a Muslim cemetery and the burial of this man here would not help the forgiveness of the other inmate, occupants of the graveyard. Rather, they thought it would have a negative effect on their forgiveness. That a filthy man, wrong man has been buried so close to them, so God will perhaps let them have the taste of hell because of this person being so close. I mean, this is the mullah's logic anyway. So the body was ordered to be dug up and removed. When they did it, everybody was surprised to see that the body was absolutely intact. There was no bad smell and it looked so fresh after a month or 2 months, I'm talking of that period, that many a local people, members of the local